In 1976, a new but now well-known artificial intelligence researcher, Drew McDermott of the MIT AI Lab, and then the Yale AI Project, wrote an essay entitled Artificial Intelligence Meets Natural Stupidity. He began, quote, as a field, artificial intelligence has always been on the border of respectability and therefore on the border of crackpottery. Many critics have urged that we are over the border. McDermott articulates a border between intelligence and stupidity, and what, according to McDermott, moves one across this border. To stay on the side of science, he says, we need self-discipline. And mistakes move one to the other side, into the stupid. McDermott gives examples of three kinds of mistakes that make artificial intelligence research stupid. First are those he calls wishful mnemonics. He says, a major source of simple-mindedness in AI programs, artificial intelligence programs, is the use of mnemonics like understand or goal to refer to programs and data structures. Instead of these mnemonics, McDermott advocates that we use nonsense symbols to name the different parts of our code and then run the program to see if anything like goals or understanding emerge. Second is something he calls unnatural language. He wrote, I wish to rail against the pervasive sloppiness in our thinking, the tendency to see in natural language a natural source of problems and solutions. The mistake he elaborates on in this section of his paper is one in which the programmer conflates internal and external representations. He condemns the idea, for instance, of using images stored in a database as an explanation for vision. Equally misdirected, according to McDermott, is to use internal data structures containing English words to represent the meaning of English sentences. A contemporary form of this fallacy would be to type a sentence into Google, expecting the search engine to tease out its subtleties and presuppositions before it returns a search result. He does not have a solution for this mistake. Instead, he calls for more studies of what language is for and the development of complex programs with a need to talk. McDermott described the third mistake like this, a common idiocy in AI research. Is to suppose that having identified the shortcomings of version 1 of a program is equivalent to having written version 2. He discusses this problem from the perspective of an academic who is not rewarded for writing the next version of a program because it is not sufficiently new and different from the first version. His proposed solution is to divide graduate programs into two periods of time. McDermott wrote, the first half of the time is allotted, should be applied to writing version n plus 1, where n is the version number you started with. The second half should be devoted to writing the report and improving version n plus 1. With enough breath, clean code, and new user features to make it useful to the next person that needs it. So despite his provocative title, Artificial Intelligence Meets Natural Stupidity, McDermott outlined a position that is not oppositional, is not skeptical, is hardly critical. Unlike some early AI critics, such as Joseph Weizenbaum and Hubert Dreyfus, McDermott's is not an argument that AI is a stupid enterprise. Rather, he asserts a border between artificial intelligence and natural stupidity, and then provides proposals for those of his colleagues who want to stay out of stupid territory. Fundamentally, the proposals he makes to the three problems of wishful mnemonics, unnatural language, and versioning are proposals to write better code and to desist from claiming that code does something more than it actually does. More recently, the journalist Nicholas Carr leveled a charge against AI that differs significantly from McDermott's in an Atlantic Monthly cover story titled, Is Google Making Us Stupid? Carr wrote, As we come to rely on computers to mediate our understanding of the world, it is our intelligence that flattens into artificial intelligence. Now, Carr's worry was that by using AI technologies, we risk becoming as stupid as AI by flattening our intelligence into AI's profile. Carr was working with very different presuppositions than McDermott. Carr presupposes that artificial intelligence is stupid, and users are at risk for becoming just as stupid. McDermott, in contrast, assumes that artificial intelligence, at least in principle, can be intelligent, and that those at risk are the software developers, and not the end users of the AI technology. The problem with Carr's technique, and Carr himself brings this up, is that with the introduction of each new media technology, there have always been critics who scream that the new technology will make us stupid. From the transition of oral cultures to written cultures, from the advent of the printing press, from the introduction of cinema to the invention of television to the internet to today, there have always been critics, starting with Plato, who worried that we will be dumbed down, our minds will be weakened, our mental capacities will be truncated. Remember that in American slang, the television used to be called the idiot box. These worries about new media, making mental life so easy that we will all become idiots, have been accompanied by a moral panic that the new technologies are either inherently evil or will debase us by seducing us into immoral behavior. And Joseph Weizenbaum, author of the famous early AI program, the chatbot Eliza, in 1966, Weizenbaum raised just such a moral critique against AI. It may be the case that Carr and prior critics are correct, but that seems pretty unlikely, unless you imagine that everyone centuries ago was much more intelligent and morally superior to the bunch of us who inhabit the Earth today. McDermott sought to help prevent AI researchers from doing something stupid, and Carr worried that AI makes it stupid. My current concern is that AI, and its contemporary form, is stupid. Even if it is not making each of us individually stupid, collectively we are risking too much by putting an idiot behind the wheel, both metaphorically and literally too, if you think about self-driving cars. So what do I mean by stupid? My diagnosis follows Gilles Deleuze. The problem of stupidity lies in a specific image of thought. My former professor, John Reichman, explained that for Deleuze, each philosophy invents a distinctive aeon with its own dramatis persona. In each, we find what Deleuze comes to call an image of thought, even if the image is not always obvious. Each of the persona through which a philosophy dramatizes its ideas suggests a manner in which philosophy is oriented and the kind of struggle in which it is involved. Plato invented the persona of Socrates and his aeon with the sophist. Kant instead invents the judge watching over the bounds of reason, and so forth. In each case, we have different ways the contest or the game of philosophy is played. So I'm going to focus on two dramatic personae, and they both come from Alan Turing. And the first is the figure of the human computer. So he wrote about this figure in his 1936 paper that was entitled Uncomputable Numbers. So it's largely considered to be the founding document of computer science. The second is the imitator, Turing wrote about in a paper 15 years later, in 1951, Computing, Machinery, and Intelligence. And this paper is the founding text of artificial intelligence. So today, as a field of study, artificial intelligence is considered to be a specialization within computer science. Yet, when one reads these papers, it's clear to see that they outline very different projects. My contention is that Turing's first dramatis persona, the human computer, has completely overtaken his second persona, the persona of artificial intelligence, and that his first persona converges with what Deleuze calls a dogmatic image of thought, the very picture of stupidity. So the crucial first step in Turing's 1936 paper is a formalization that starts as a rough analogy. To understand how this analogy might have been interpreted in 1936, you need to know that at the time, computers were not machines, computers were people. Or, more specifically, computing was a job held by people, frequently women. Computers worked in teams for large governmental and corporate concerns to calculate large tables of numbers for ballistics, astronomy, the insurance industry. Consequently, hearing the word computer in 1936, one would not think of a machine, but of a person. Turing's 1936 paper is based on an extended analogy between the work of a human computer and the working of a machine. He essentially formalizes the computer's job into very exact operations susceptible to formal analysis and proof. And in section one of Computing Machines, Turing wrote, quote, "We may compare a man in the process of computing a real number to a machine which is only capable of a finite number of conditions." Now, Ludwig Wittgenstein, the famous philosopher and one of Turing's professors, pinpointed this dramatis persona as the focus of Turing's invention. "These machines," said Wittgenstein, "are humans who calculate." These computers, these human calculators, had been at work for centuries before the publication of Turing's machine. For example, computers worked together in the 18th century to predict the return trajectory of Halley's Comet. These computers were the French mathematician Clairaut and the astronomers De La Pierre, Le Put, and De Lalande. The three friends began their computations of Halley's Comet in June of 1757. They worked at a common table in the Palais Luxembourg, using goose quill pens and heavy linen paper. Lalande and Le Put worked at one side of the table and handed their results to Clairaut. The difference from Clairaut et al. Is that Turing imagined his computer to be working alone and not with friends or colleagues. In the paper, he excludes collaboration, and he articulates this limitation in section two, declaring his focus was automatic machines, and contrasting these with another kind that he calls choice machines. Choice machines are those in which an external operator can be consulted. In other words, Turing machines are not machines of interaction, but rather machines of isolated automatic calculation. So note that Turing's automatic machines are very different from most of what we use computers for today. Search engines, cell phones, websites are all choice machines. They're not Turing machines. Machines of interaction exceed the definition of Turing machines. Turing machines are algorithms, and algorithms do not support interaction. They can only execute isolated calculation, and consequently, most of the software systems we use on a daily basis are not algorithms. Because it concerns isolated calculation and not interaction, Turing's dramatis persona draws on a figure even older than the figure of the human computers who worked in teams. His is a figure from 15th century Venice, the industrial businessman calculating alone. This dramatis persona is the foundational figure of algorithms referenced by Turing. Algorithms arrived in Europe with the translation of texts of Muslim scholarship about the Hindu system of numbers. The then new to Europe Hindu representation of numbers was what we know today as the ubiquitous everyday decimal system. Eventually, the system of algorithms, performed with pen and paper, replaced the older means of arithmetic in which an abacus was used. So at the birth of mercantile capitalism, the arithmetic of shopkeepers became a matter of algorithms rather than the abacus, and thus ultimately the advantages of the algorithms of the decimal system overtook the perceived advantages of the abacus. Young men from throughout Europe came to Venice to learn the new algorithms essential to capitalism. As these algorithms of arithmetic became more popular, reckoning schools were established in many cities beyond Venice. In 1338, Florence had six such schools, but by 1613, the city of Nuremberg had 48 such schools. While arithmetic was essential to mercantile capitalism, it became even more important to the rise of industrial capitalism in the 19th century. In this period, two changes to arithmetic were seminal. First, recasting work in a format that allowed it to be measured and estimated in quantitative terms was essential to spelling out how labor and capital could be connected through money. How much would it cost to have a given piece of work done? Would it be worth the cost for the capitalist to invest in expensive machinery to replace human laborers? The recasting of work into a quantitative form, a form that boils it down to just one number, is what I call the work language of construction, steam engines, and information technologies. And that's another chapter of the book. Second was not just an industrial, but also an epistemological shift that put extended forms of arithmetic at the center of many previously distinct disciplines of knowledge. In the history of mathematics and logic, this shift is referred to as arithmetization. A research program in the foundations of mathematics. Arithmetization, or let's just call it the rise of arithmetic, largely shaped many important developments of 20th century mathematics and logic, including Turing's 1936 paper. Taken together, these strands of the story narrate the rise of arithmetic, or if you prefer, the collapse of everything to calculation. This rise or collapse has taken place over the course of centuries, fueled by both intellectual and industrial concerns, and currently proceeds under the rubric of digitization or digital convergence. The contemporary culmination of digitalization is the recasting of our most important intellectual operations, like learning, as extended forms of arithmetic. This is a point to which I will return in a moment. The second of Turing's papers I want to discuss was written 15 years later in 1951. Computing, Machinery, and Intelligence was the founding article of artificial intelligence, and it was staged around a very different set of figures than his 1936 paper. We can easily see the contrast if we again focus on the dramatic persona. In his 1951 essay, Turing proposes a Wittgensteinian language game, the imitation game, to replace the question of can machines think. Turing's imitation game includes a proposal to program a computer to play the role of a man attempting to imitate a woman. An intriguing proposal concerning the reproduction and representation of gender difference. Turing describes the imitation game like this. It is played with three people, a man, a woman, and an interrogator, who may be of either sex. The interrogator stays in a room apart from the other two. The object of the game for the interrogator is to determine which of the other two is the man and which is the woman. It is the man's object in the game to try to cause the interrogator to make the wrong identification. The object of the game for the woman is to help the interrogator. We now ask the question, what will happen when a machine takes the part of the man in this game? Will the interrogator decide wrongly as often when the game is played like this as he does when the game is played between a man and a woman? These questions replace our original question, can machines think? So in the literature of artificial intelligence and its various popularizations, Turing's imitation game is usually incorrectly renamed the Turing test and re-narrated to exclude any notion of gender difference. In contemporary popular and technical forums, Turing is misunderstood to have proposed a test to to compare the performance of a computer program with a human of unspecified gender. In the 1960s and 1970s, a large number of AI projects were developed to address the challenges Turing raised in his 1951 paper. But now it is almost never mentioned in the technical literature of artificial intelligence. When it is, it's referred to as a test, not a game. It's very specifically a game. AI has collapsed into a discourse about a set of algorithms and no longer seriously addresses the aesthetics of Dublin and the uncanny raised by Turing's original thought on the subject. So the easiest way to see this degeneration of AI into algorithmic calculation is to try to peek into the black boxes that power the currently hyped AI, those that do the so-called machine learning on big data. Consider, for example, Google's online machine translation system. In 2016, Google completely rewrote it using some new techniques from machine learning. The Google software engineers responsible for this published a series of papers on the overhaul, including one entitled Google's Multilingual Neural Machine Translation System Enabling Zero-Shot Translation. All these are available on Google's site, and they've also been published in public, that is to say, public technical conferences. So the phrase neural machine translation refers to a relatively new machine learning technique for neural networks, but note also at this moment, neural network, or so-called deep machine learning, is astoundingly popular and regularly covered in non-technical mass publications like The Economist and the New York Times, but usually under the rubric of artificial intelligence. But what exactly are these neural networks, also called multi-layer perceptrons? Neuroscientists have been interested in logic circuits, and mathematical logicians have been interested in neurons, at least since the 1943 publication of Warren McCulloch and Walter Pitt's paper on the simulation of neural networks by logic circuits. But to the untrained eye, it is hard to see how anyone can find a computational form of neural networks in any actual living biological system, because in its simplest form, perceptron is just a weighted sum of inputs. The inputs are x1 to xd, the weights are w1 to wd, the summation sign, that sigma there, indicates that each of the products of wi, xi should be added together. So the sum is now what, this sum is now what artificial intelligence machine learning can look like. So-called machine learning happens when the weights in the sum are adjusted up or down. In short, the big news here is that even learning has become a form of arithmetic. And this form of arithmetic currently constitutes the conceptual framework for everything from computational linguistics, search engines, and self-driving cars. So Deleuze anticipated this sad state of affairs almost 50 years ago. He wrote, quote, problems are now traced from algebraic equations and evaluated according to the possibility of carrying out a series of operations on the coefficients of the equation, which provide the roots. This is how we pursue the hard work of reducing problems to the form of propositions capable of serving as cases of solution. And we see this clearly in Descartes. The Cartesian method is a method for solving supposedly given problems, not a method of invention appropriate to the constitution of problems or the understanding of questions. This Cartesianism, or what I want to call an over-reliance on arithmetic, is stupid because, according to Deleuze, stupidity is the faculty for false problems. It is evidence of an inability to constitute, comprehend, or determine a problem as such. Unfortunately, the polynomials of deep learning are even worse, are even more stupid than Descartes' polynomials. Why? Because the polynomials of contemporary machine learning are enormous. For example, the Google translation system I mentioned is one such weighted sum that incorporates literally billions of parameters. Billions. These are polynomials so large that no one, even if they spent their whole life doing it, could read it through once, much less understand it. We are by investing in this newest form of artificial intelligence, betting our lives on black boxes that cannot be opened for inspection or even explained. But as Deleuze makes clear, it is not just risky to reduce all problems to a fancy form of arithmetic, it is stupid. Once we buy into the idea that a deep learning algorithm can be deployed to solve any problem, we have yielded the judgment to determine whether or not something really is a problem. And even if it is a problem, the only kind of misadventure of thought, as Deleuze puts it, we can now imagine is a miscalculation, is an error. Within this framework, all problems of thought get reduced to errors of arithmetic. And Deleuze insisted that, quote, the terrible trinity of madness, stupidity, and malevolence can no more be reduced to error than they can be reduced to any form of the same. So there are ways out of this impasse. One way would be simply to swear off deep learning technologies, but that's unlikely to happen, or unlikely to happen until some arithmetic error results in a huge disaster. Another way out of the impasse is to refocus our efforts on interaction, design, and away from calculation and the analysis of algorithms. That is to say, to make artificial intelligence less stupid, we need to reconsider the Wittgensteinian language game, the imitation game, originally proposed by Turing, a game of interaction between people. We need to think deeply about what constitutes a problem and why. And until we do, with the current mania for deep learning, everything looks like a problem that can be solved with the techniques of machine learning. We're like the carpenter who only has a hammer and so imagines everything to be a nail. Marvin Minsky, one of the founders of artificial intelligence and formerly one of my professors at MIT, used to say, quote, "You don't understand anything until you understand it in multiple ways." So, for instance, an electron can be understood as a wave or as a particle. But if you only understand it as a wave, many of its particle-like properties will be enigmatic. So stupidity is trying to understand everything in one way.